Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we continue with the series of videos I'm doing about MLOPS, and today we will look at the framework BitNet.cpp, a Microsoft framework designed to run inference auth model training with one bit. So you probably, if you are following the channel, you probably saw that many of the videos I've been doing in the recent times is around the topic of how to use or what are the new techniques that have been developed in the industry to extend or universalize the use of the LLMs. My conclusion on that topic that most of the actors in the industry are moving into the direction or using different techniques or applying different techniques to speed up the training. In the training, they are more designing new advances on the architecture, and using you will see in this case even quantization during the training, not only applying techniques like LoRa, QLoRa, or DLoRa. These techniques which train a new matrix sets that later on we applied on top of the weights. Also, as I mentioned, quantization and optimizations in terms of the way that how we organize the matrix multiplications involved during the feed forward phase and the consequent back propagation of the gradients during the training. In inference, at the same time, many of the advances are also in that direction, using quantization, and many of the ideas and new advances are going into the direction of removing the use of GPUs during inference and being able to do inference using bigger models in local using cheap hardware without losing speed, reducing the memory footprint, therefore reducing the amount of money that we spend to do to generate a token. In that direction, we explore during the recent months runtimes like Open by Node and TensorRT as well, but this is also to use, is mostly to use on GPU, ONNX framework, Llama CPP, and different quantization techniques, compression techniques, some of the main actors on the industry, like Microsoft or others, or Intel, are developing frameworks to use with other languages rather than only in Python. You probably know, like me, you are a practitioner or you are a professional working on this area, that today, the predominant actor in this industry in terms of the infrastructure be used for training and inference is NVIDIA, and the predominant language is Python. Yeah, this is a fact. We can argue the in terms of how much they cope on the market, NVIDIA and Python, but majoritarily for the past 5 years, we can go back probably more in terms of Python if we consider Python. But these two technologies today are the ones that are coping this market, if you want to say that. And then on this is essentially is not bad, but there is a problem here that we simply depends on to the technologies for to not only for the training, which somebody may argue that is something that is a particular phase of the creation of the model, but especially for the inference phase. No, in inference, it should be something a phase where this can be used for anybody, any place, and for a really reasonable cost. And then up to now, practically everything that we were deploying to prod had to run in a very expensive hardware. It's very difficult to get rid of the use of GPUs, and majoritarily, I don't know if you know real examples of people that are not using Python for inference as well. Probably, depending how you deploy the endpoint, you may have some choices with Rust or with C or with .NET, but not majoritarily. Sometimes you are working in Databricks with Scala, but again, similarly to training, inference is being a process which majoritarily is done using NVIDIA hardware and Python. So, like what we see on the recent months, and it's not more than 1 year, it has been a lot of the improvements coming from Microsoft, coming from Intel, coming from different research, different actors as well in the industry, that they are moving a lot of, or they are developing or creating, trying to move part of this, or the process, you know, speeding up the process of running inference in cheap hardware, CPUs, and also use different languages to create runtimes that are really effective at the inference time, following the kind of the approach that everybody or is understanding that the on the industry, that is train and fine tuning Python, and then on do the inference whenever and wherever or using whatever you want, and obviously using as cheaper hardware as possible to be able to run not only in expensive endpoints using cloud providers like Azure, Google or Amazon, also be able to use the LLMs in small devices without GPUs, like mobile telephones or embedded devices, of doing inference on the edge. On devices that especially that devices not having access to GPUs, and where deploying applications in Python is not really the best idea, no? And then we saw during last months different techniques, runtimes, different techniques that are developing different universities, researchers, companies in the direction. One of them is the one that we are going to see today. It's BitNet. BitNet was the paper was released, the era of 1-bit LLMs was released this year in February. And essentially, they come with the idea, well, everybody's going in the direction to quantization, to reduce the memory footprint, the computational resources that you need to do inference and training, because this technique is also used in training, like others that we already saw. And essentially, do all this stuff without losing quality on the prediction. So they came with the idea of using just one bit and transform the complex operations that we do usually on the GPUs with the floating point 32 or floating point 16, where we mostly, and for that is what we're, well, that that was the reason to move this processing to the GPU, because the GPUs are specialized in doing operation with matrices, and they are this parallel computing that they are designed to do is very optimal to do this kind of operations where we have complex and numbers with a with high precision and in a format of matrices. So moving data, it makes sense to when we are using numbers with high precision, and we need to do operations of the vectors, matrices, the best place to do it by design is the GPU or a TPU or acceleration hardware, because it's designed to do that essentially. But as we saw last year, well this is and I think it's gonna be as well for a long time something that we will keep for training, but for inference, and especially at today when everybody's trying to use LLMs to solve a business case, a use case, where we cannot access to do this in GPUs or to in for many of the use cases that now are being demanded on the industry. So the idea behind is just simply reduce the complexity of this operation to be able to move the operation away or out of the GPU. And then on first of all, reducing the precision to the, well, I don't think that we can reduce it even more because we are reducing for 32 to 16 floating point or brain flow 16, the number or the precision designed by Google. And finally, we move into 8 bits, 4 bits, and finally 1 bit. That finally ends up in a 3 states term, which three values, 1, 0, and -1. This way, we not only reduce the size of the model and the demand of the storage, either in memory or in hard disks or permanent storage, or even the bandwidth that we need to move the model through the different hierarchies or layers of our memory. Also, reducing the complexity, as it's not the same to do a, even if we keep the matrix calculations, that is something that we will have to do probably ever, no? The way that the neural networks are designed, we just simply had weights per layers, and at inference time, we will always do a calculations that this is very simplistic, obviously. The calculations are going to be something very similar to this, no? A matrix of weights multiplied by an input vector, and then on to some additions to calculate the output. No? If we reduce one way the size of the precision, and additionally we reduce the complexity of the operation, we will be able to move this to a new hardware where it's not necessary to do this parallelization of the multiplications of these matrices. And why we can do that? Because, well, you can see here that the output of the multiplication, we are not removing the multiplications, we are just simplifying the multiplications, and then what we do is just simply we have three status after the multiplication of this vector to this other vector, to the input vector, either the same value or the value inverted the sign or zero. So it's, we don't need to go through a very complex multiplication of two values in floating points, considering all the mantissa, decimals, etc. So we are simply have three values, three possible values, same but with different sign, negative or positive, negative, positive, but the same value, and zero. The additions keep the same, and then no change on that, but you can understand that it's really easy or easier to do this operation rather to do the same but in a floating point. The challenge here is how to do this without losing precision in our model. So they design in this paper, they analyze how they were doing. They change the original linear layers where we finally do the inference with bit linear layers and with three values, and they do to quantize or the ways they do two operations. One is rounding, one is scaling the weights, and the second one is rounding and clipping the values to the three possible ones. Once it's done, we can train the model using this technique, just replacing in our architecture the linear layers for bilinear layers, and then on at inference time. During the training process, we already will use these three values. And then on the output of this research is this model, BitNet B1.58, which is originally a llama model, different sizes, and you can see here how it's reducing the memory footprint, increasing or reducing as well the latency, and how the perplexity and cost is being reduced. No? Same size, you can see the reduction practically to 35-40% of the size of the model. Remember that we cannot quantize all the layers in a model. A batch normalization layers, for example, cannot be quantized. And you can see here the comparison in zero-shot prompting versus different benchmarks. So the loss in performance is not very significant. It's obviously a reduce, but you can see here the average is not 1%. It's a loss. It's always a trade-off in between, what you win and what you lose. Here, my opinion, modest opinion, this loss is worth it to do it. No? If you are reducing, as you will see now, 70%. This is the basis, the fundamentals of how the models are trained, how what the comparison. Here you have even the comparison with models, 70 billion parameters, and the equivalent in BitNet architecture with 1.5 bits. And what are the reductions in terms of memory latency, energy, throughput, etc., etc. So, You have interest, I really recommend you to read this document, because it gives you an idea of how the brains in this industry are where they are putting the focus, and I think, in my opinion, this is the direction in how many of the things that we will see soon are gonna be done. And then on the second paper is the framework BitNet CPP, which is essentially an extension of the Llama CPP. You probably are familiar with that. It's a framework designed in C++, but I forgot the name. Leave me one second. Yeah, sorry, I forgot. It's Gerganov. This genius, this person which developed this framework essentially in C++. Everything is running under the hood in a compiled language, very fast, close to the CPU. The operations are native operations, as you may understand. We are developing in a low-level language like C or C++, and then on top of that, we use an API to which connect with the binaries in C++. Essentially, the same is, in fact, to use the framework BitNet, you need to install Llama CPP, because it's essentially using all the techniques that are being implemented in Llama CPP to run the BitNet CPP, which had to say the framework has been developed by Microsoft. So as you can see here, Llama CPP has been released. Today is 4th of November 2024, so it was released 2 weeks ago. But, so you probably will need to consider that still is very incipient, these changes. We are really at the beginning of what we will see on the future. Here you had the... At the beginning of the paper, this really interesting plot, how they are comparing the speed of the models up to how is speed. Here you had the comparison to Llama CPP and the original framework. In here, the BitNet, and here... So they say that the human reading speed is 5.7 tokens second. So here, the framework is today able to work even with models up to 100 billions of parameters, and still is keeping the speed, no, or the throughput to be able to be used in a production environment, if you want to say that. The test I did today in my domestic computer doesn't show that, but as I said, I can imagine that the guys who developed this or who wrote this paper were doing this in a lab environment. I perfectly understand. Today I'm doing the test in my local computer, where I'm not only using the computer to do the inference, I'm using the computer as well to show you this on the screen, to record. It's doing a lot of things at the same time, so it's not a dedicated CPU for that. And then probably is one of the reasons that we don't get the same output. But you will see during the demo that it's not bad. We are going to use a model in this area, in between 8 Llama 3 8 billion model, already trained with the 1.58. This model right here in Hugging Face is a model which tensors is in the size is a model of the 8 billions of parameters. A Llama 3 which quantize is 3.85. Later we will take a look to the original size with floating point. I think it's 24 gigabytes. I will check later, I forgot. But well, you can see here that the model is already trained, so we are going to use only the process. We will only transform the model to GGUF and use it to do inference in my local computer. So this is the framework. The library which is doing that is BitNet.cpp. That again is an extension of Llama CPP. And as I said, you can see here the improvement is obvious. Here with Llama CPP, we are using, in this case, if I don't remember wrong, this is inference in with M2 Ultra, floating point 16. And in our case is 1 bit. How the throughput is being increased using different size. This is inference speed tokens per second. So then, well, the claim is here that we are still able to read at a normal speed where the human being is get used to read or to read information that even in a book or produced by a model. Take a look to the documents. Are really, really interested. They prepare some kernels to optimize the process. This is everything at the end is running around the idea of creating specific kernels or runtimes to speed up the inference process. As you probably know, the inference process is really more simple than the training, and then we can, as I mentioned at the beginning, we can use a completely different approach because we don't need to do the backward propagation, and then it's much more easier to simplify the process and be able to use a hardware which is not that complex and that expensive than a GPU. So we keep the processing in the CPU. This is the idea. This is somehow as well my objective. You can see here the comparisons in CPU with Llama CPP and with in an Apple, in a Intel i7 with 64 gigabytes of memory. So it's practically duplicating in Intel. So it's curious how in Intel, the CPUs in Intel are really faster in comparison with the ones in here. Even it was not applicable, probably they cannot load in memory these models, 30 gigabytes. And here exactly, CPU cannot host the specific model with the kernel. Energy cost, this already today is a very controversial topic, but I agree that we are reducing the cost. Is also we are reducing as well the cost of the energy, no, the energy that we need to produce our token. And then this is also another cost that we need to consider, the energy footprint. This memory footprint, energy footprint at the end of the day is always cost, no? And the ability as well to run this. So obviously, if we spend 70% less of the energy, we need as well less refrigeration or our CPUs or our GPUs. Everything is I don't know what they include in this estimation, but it's just very simple. When you are using a GPU 100% of your ability to work, the GPU or the CPU is becoming very hot, it's increasing the temperature, and you need to refrigerate the hardware. It's not it will melt. It's as simple as that. You need energy, not only the energy to feed or to power the hardware, is also the energy that you need to refrigerate the hardware and to keep it in the operation temperature. So it's saving everything, the idea, as I mentioned before, here you have how much is reducing using the different kernels. Okay. And well, let's see a little bit now a demo. I will explain you how we do the quantization. It's pretty simple. First of all, there is a calculation, an scaling factor using all the values, absolute values we have in our weight matrix. So essentially, we sum up all the values in absolute values, and then we divide by the number of the elements in the matrix. This is the scaling factor. Then we scale every single element in the matrix. So here we calculate, let's take this example. We had these values, is usually the weight matrices are much more complex than this, but this is just a simplification of the process. Just we calculate the absolute values of every element in the matrix, and then we sum them up, and we divide it by the number of elements. So here 03, 07, 05, 01 is 1.6, divided by 4 is 0.4. Then on we scale the matrix, we divide by 0.4 every single element, and then on we do the max of this is A and B are the minimum value, in this case minus one, the B is plus one, and of the value, so max mean of the rounded value of our matrix element. So let's apply this to our scaled matrix. So here we have 0.7, rounded value is one. Minus 1.75, rounded value is minus 2. 1.25 is 1, and 0.25 is 0. So here, now we are, this is the rounding, here 1, minus 2, 1, 0. So now, mean max of the 1 is 1, minus 2 is minus 1, is the closest value is minus 1, is we calculate the minimum of the x and the value is minus 1, and then on the max of minus 2 and minus 1 is minus 1. Here 1 is one of the edges, 1, and 0 is one of the values of the matrix. So we are reducing all the elements to only 3 possible values, and with this we just calculate the inference. This is how we apply this quantization process. As you can see, it's very simple. Now, once we have this, do the operations. The 6 operations that we need to do during the inference are really, really simple. As I mentioned before, if you have now a vector to an input vector, you either get the same value when you multiply this matrix when you use this matrix to multiply versus an input vector, you either get the same value, input value, the same value but with negative or opposite sign, or you get zero. So there is no more possibilities here, which is simplifying the operations a lot. To install the framework, you just need, I did it in Ubuntu, in Debian, I have a Debian 9, Windows or System Linux with Debian 9, you can do the same for Ubuntu 22.04, the host is a Windows 11 Pro. You update and install the prerequirements, install CMake to build the binaries, and then on CLang to compile the binaries. CMake and CLang, if you have it, you can also do the same in Windows. In Windows, you need to have the Dev Studio 2022, they recommend, and also to have CMake and CLang versions for Windows. Once you have that, you clone the repo, you create a conda environment, install the requirements. All this stuff is here. I'm not, this is not mine, it's only the requirements here. The requirements, once you have installed the environment, you install, if you don't have the Hugging Face CLI, this is not included on the requirements, and then on, if you don't have it, it will fail. So to install it and log in into Hugging Face hat, either you had a environmental variable hf underscore token, or you do a login on the hat, because it's not here when you are converting the model to I2 format in GGUF, it will fail because it's unable to download the model. This model from the hub, no? The process is downloading this model and then on convert it to GGUF. What more? Now once we have it, we just simply use the script run inference, which is essentially loading the model from. It's pretty simple, loading the model from the path where the conversion process levied, and do the inference. Is pretty simple. You can do the same here, but this process is adapted to the model is following the transformers. Is completely compatible with transformer library. So the same way that we use GUF models, you can use it with transformers. You can use it with the Llama C code, or you can use it. You can use both. No, the model is absolutely compatible with both libraries. So, oops. Let me, 1 second, now we go to the code. Yeah, so the process is, during the process, I think I have it here, the conversion process, I do some tests here, run inference, this is, you are familiar with the GGUF with the Llama or Llama, you probably saw very similar logs when you are running inference on Llama or Llama CPP or Llama. Here, when you run the setup environment and converting, this is essentially downloading the model. So compiling the code, this is generating the banner. This process takes kind of 3 hours approximately, compiling the code, downloading the models to local, and then on convert it to GGUF format. And once you have been done that, so this is after, obviously, after installing all the requirements, after install the libraries, etc. And then on you can do inference. Here we will run, so running the inference, as you can see here, let's do an example. We will use something I create before. Let me use a temperature of 9 and 256. So, oops, here there is, let me write it down here at the bottom. So to do inference, so first of all, sorry, the setup process, which is downloading and converting the model into from safe tensors, the transformers format into GGUF. Here you had the original model in floating point 32, which is 32. So it's practically reducing, I will say it's kind of the 12% of the original size. And well, in terms of the comparison with this tensor, they are practically the same, a little bit bigger, obviously, in GGUF. But yeah, same size. You know, the model was already trained, as I mentioned before, with I2. So the only thing that we are doing with this process is transforming to GGUF to be able to use the BitNet CPP framework. Now, to do the inference, simply run Python, run inference, hyperemp, you point to the model, hyperp, the prompt. This is one of the prompts I used to use when I evaluate the models for a chain of thoughts, answer, number of new tokens, 256, temperature, and context window, 248. Well, it had to be 2048, but doesn't really matter. It's just an example. I let you try in your local computer. You can see here. Now it's loading the model in memory. It's going to create the KV cache, loading the memory in your local run. And once start that, it will be start the generation of tokens. You will see, we will start the process and then we will finalize the video. That the speed of my computer is an Intel i7 with 64 gigabytes of memory, but as you can see at the moment I'm doing the inference and I also recording this video, I have different applications open, so it's not fully dedicated to the inference process, so probably that's the reason that is running a little bit slower than what the researchers or the creators of the library claims to have. Yeah, I say try to do this in your local computer. Now still we are on the process of loading the model. It's taking kind of 1 minute approximately. Once the model is there, we will get some logs of the loading process, and after that start the inference process. Okay, I don't want to stop this because I want you to see how long it takes. Also, to you later be able to try. You have other hardware. You have an AMD. You have other kind of hardware. Maybe it's worthy also to you check out. I don't have an Apple, so I cannot do that. I have different Intel machines, but not an Apple. I'm not usually use Apple. Okay, here we are. So it's already in memory. You can see here we just create as well a buffer for our KV calculations in CPU and start the process. Now it's just printing the prompt and then on it will start to answer. So system info, we are using just two threads. We can use more threads if we want. Not really sure that it will have an impact. Let me one second. Let's see here in the parameters model number of threads. We can check. Let's do it. By the way, we are gonna check here. Minus t 6. Sorry, I will stop that to is loading. Okay, now it's again, we are in the inference process, as you can see. Yeah, it's not that fast than the client. Remember that this model is a Llama 3 base, 8 gigabytes. This 100 billions is the number of the tokens that contains the data set that they use for training. It's not the number of the parameters of the token, so it's not bad, to be honest, and it's really promising what is how it's going to be in the future, the near future. So it's good. I think again probably so it's nobody could imagine 1 year ago that we can do this in a CPU to this speed, no? So let's think that probably in 1 year this will be something that is really realistic even with the bigger models. So this is going as we mentioned a lot of times in our conversations that this is going so fast. Every day there is new things that is my opinion is gonna be really, really so, to be honest, sometimes with a small GPU this probably with the original precision with the original precision we cannot run it in my computer. That's the starting point. 32 gigabytes model, you cannot run it in a computer. So here you can see how it's doing the inference process. So it's it seems that to have a good logic. The previous run when I record the video for the Spanish community, he make correctly the calculations. And fight apples. Yeah, it's not that clear than the resolution I saw in other models, but still it's a kind of following a logic. I don't know where an apple to the neighbor. This I don't know from where it's taking that, but okay. It's it's probably too much temperature. We have one upper left in total. Yeah, it's funny because it's you see how he's stating, which is what we had at the beginning. So it's recognizing that we had the same the answer to this question is 10 apples. So it's correct that we after all these operations we have the same apples that we had at the beginning. But how it's getting these calculations is not completely correct. So, but again, this questions of the kind of the tax is very hard for any model. You probably, if you are following the channel, you saw I did the same test with many models. And not many not just a few of them, and obviously commercial ones were able to solve all the questions I formulate to the models, except the recently the first one, non-commercial and with a reasonable site, which answered the questions, was the Microsoft V3 Instruct with 128 key or context windows, and then on after that the Llama 3.2, 3 billions of parameters, which also answer these questions, all of them correctly. You are interested on that, just let me know. I can point you out to some of the videos that we have on the channel where we formulate the question. Okay, it's not a matter for now. We will see this in probably we will review this topic in the near future, once probably the technology is a little bit more established. Now I think there is many people testing, saying that we and then on in some months we will see that for sure there is new advance on this matter. Okay, that's pretty much all. I will upload now the notebook to the repo with all the information that you need to run and to install this stuff, to do well the research papers and some info I found interesting about the topic, and then on again some documents that people already wrote in Medium and how to install it and do the inference, and then you can test it on your local environment. Okay, that's pretty much all. Thank you very much for watching the video up to this point. I hope that you find it interesting and useful for your job, for your training, for whatever reason are you watching this video. And if so, just give me a like, subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and yeah, keep tuned, make comments, share with your friends and colleagues just to help me to grow in YouTube. Thank you very much and see you soon.